Thank you. Well, welcome to all of you. David and Karissa and their families are delighted that you have gathered here this afternoon with them to participate in the joy of witnessing their marriage. Would you please join me in prayer? Father in heaven, creator of all things, we thank you for the many evidences this evening of your presence and power, of your kindness and grace. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for being with us and for ordaining this day to come. We ask that you would bless each one here, and especially now David and Karissa, as they enter into the sacred covenant of marriage. Lord Jesus, remind us all this afternoon of your special love for us and for your bride, the church. May we each one come to know your love in a personal way as we witness it being imaged and modeled in marriage. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. You guys look great. Well, family and friends, we're gathered together here today in the sight of God and these witnesses to join together David Dobbins and Karissa Knudtson in marriage. Marriage is an honorable estate, which means it's a big deal. Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 4 says, "Let marriage be held in honor among all. It was instituted by God in the time of creation for the well-being of humanity," which means it was designed to be awesome and fun. It was designed to bring joy. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, it says, "It is not good that the man should be alone." And it was instituted for the display of God's unfailing love toward us, which means that marriage is really about Jesus and what he did for us through his sacrificial love on the cross. Marriage is a union close and enduring, a relationship in which a man and a woman forsake all others to become one. This abiding union illustrates the holy relationship between Christ and his bride, the church. Marriage is therefore not to be entered into lightly, but with a sense of weighty joy, with reverence and celebration. And so, David and Karissa, I charge you both as you stand in the presence of God today to remember that the marriage covenant you are mutually entering into today is a commitment with consequences. It's a big deal. It's more than feelings. It's more than emotion. Love does not sustain your marriage covenant. Rather, your marriage covenant sustains your love. We are all here today to witness and affirm your commitment to this covenant of marriage and your love for one another. Now for a very important question. Who gives Karissa to be married to David?
Her mother and I.
Very good. We get your bride. There you go. Yeah, there you go. For some vows of intent. David, do you take Karissa to be your wedded wife, to live together in holy marriage? Do you promise to love her, comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself only for her, so long as you both shall live? And if so, say, "I do."
I do.
Amen. Karissa, do you take David to be your wedded husband, to live together in holy marriage? Do you promise to love him, comfort him, honor and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself only for him, so long as you both shall live? If so, say, "I do."
I do.
With gusto. We like that. Very good. Well, now for a little bit about the David and Karissa story. David and Karissa have a great story, and it's a story that's still in the making. It's an exciting day to be here. They've known each other for about 10 years. They literally grew up next door to each other, at least for a time, as their families lived near each other, and they remember family potlucks together from those early years. As they got a little older, their families were part of the same church. And in David's word, this was a good thing. Yes. Both Karissa and David learned to depend on God from a young age, and both of them have acknowledged Jesus as their Savior and Lord and did so early in life. And they've continued to nurture and grow in their faith and relationship with Jesus. As they entered their teenage years, at some point David thought to himself, oh, she's nice looking. So around the age of 14, freshman year in high school, David devised a brilliant plan. I'll invite her on a bike ride, and then we'll go to the Owl Soda Fountain. While this was a significant and meaningful step for David, Karissa thought, oh, this is great, we're friends. Now, apparently, Karissa didn't catch the full meaning behind the bike ride. I mean, a bike ride should be obvious, right, fellas? David's going, I mean, this is a pretty big hint here. I asked you to go on a bike ride. This is going places. Or so David thought. So as the story goes, from there, Karissa at some point convinced her brother Weston, I believe, to get a Facebook account, so that she could sort of scope out David that way. Eventually, which all weddings I do these days, Facebook plays a part. I'm just saying. Facebook finds its way into relationship development in these days. So she finally gets her own, and they sent a few messages to each other. Now, here's where the story gets really cool. The two families got together to talk and discuss the nature and process of helping these two guide the relationship and keep it on track so that it would be honoring to the Lord, to each other, and to their parents. They were young in many ways by today's standards, 14, but they wanted their relationship to be guided and guarded with their parents' involvement. Now at that meeting, Bob, David's father, astutely commented, "I don't think this is going to be over soon." As David and Karissa honored their parents' wishes regarding things like how long they hung out, what kinds of places and activities they engaged in. David at one point even emailed Karissa's dad, Stace, saying, "Can I put my arm around her?" So to that I say, well done, guys. Well done. I think that's a cool story. So when my kids, I've got two daughters and two sons, when they get around 14 or 15 and they're interested, I'm going to have you guys over for dinner and you can talk to them and tell them how it's done. That would be wonderful. So this future date, we'll get that on the calendar. Well, it was at a quinceañera party of a mutual friend during a time of dancing that, in David's words, at some point, some guy butted in. This David and Karissa were dancing. This is an important night, part of their story. Somehow David proceeds to get locked in a bathroom, and it dawns on him as his frustration level is increasing, it's not just about getting locked in the bathroom, but about some other guy dancing with Karissa. And he realized, hey, I'm not okay with that. And from that time on, they knew that God had more in store for them and their future together. So in the fall of 2012, David made the epic ring purchase, called Karissa's dad at work, set up a time to meet for lunch, and asked for his permission to marry Karissa. To which Stace replied, after asking a few questions, "I'd be really excited." So a stealth proposal plan was put in place, and on January 10th, 2013, in California, in the California Adventure theme park, while Karissa was on a trip with the Dobbins family, on the bridge at night, under the lights on Paradise Pier, David kneeled down, pulled out the ring, and asked, "Will you marry me?" Karissa saw the ring and said, "Oh, thank you." "Oh, I mean, yes." The family, peering on from a distance, joyfully waited, and out came a pre-written letter from Karissa's dad, followed by a phone call to Karissa's parents, finishing with dinner at Joe's Crab Shack. So well done, David. Well done. And well done, parents. Well done. And well done, Jesus, in bringing you two together. There's a cool legacy being built. In fact, the doors that David and Karissa walked through down the aisle were actually a part of the homestead through David's side of the family, the front and back door of the homestead of the great-grandparents, I believe, through Sherry's side. And it's a great image of the legacy that's continuing even here today as you guys get married. Well, that's just a piece of a great story already, of your guys' story in the making. And it brings us here today to your wedding. What's really great about your story and this part in it is that it is now becoming part, even more so, of telling an even greater story. The story that we all love of boy meets girl and girl meets boy in marriage, this cool little story gets caught up within an awesome, much larger narrative unfolding in the history of the world of another groom who is coming for his bride. It's the story of God, the holy creator, redeeming fallen sinners through the life, death, resurrection, and return of his one and only son, Jesus Christ. That story also begins in a gorgeous outdoor setting like we find ourselves in a garden. God created man in his image and breathed life into man and then completed the picture by taking from the side of the man and forming a woman also in the image of God, bringing her to the man. God, their creator, walked her down the aisle to the man. He saw her after picking his jaw up off of the lawn in glorious wonder. He writes a poem and sings her a love song. There's a reason we love those kinds of stories. It's where it began. In the beginning, in a garden, at an outdoor wedding, with the presence of God blessing that first union. See, there's an echo in our hearts that that scene and this setting, this story, is somehow where it all began and how it all should be. This feels right. But we all know life is much more complicated and broken now than that old garden story. Many brush off this story altogether as they experience the pain and disappointment of trial, betrayal, sickness, tragedy, and death. It started amazing in the garden, but because of lies, lusts, and willful rebellion, God was rejected, and the peace and glory of that first garden was lost. We experience it every day. Things are not as they should be. Life doesn't always go the way we think it should. But that's not the end of the story. God, in great mercy and grace, designed a plan to rescue and redeem and one day fully restore that perished garden. He sent his only son, Jesus Christ, to take upon himself the penalty for the sin, the unbelief, and the rebellion against God. Jesus came on that rescue mission. He lived perfectly for us. He died sacrificially for you on the cross, for your sins. As the perfect groom, he laid down his life for the sake of his bride. You see, in the gospel, we find unfailing love for unfaithful people. It's a story of redemption, of forgiveness, of love. A wedding and marriage then should actually remind us that that rescue mission of God's love continues to this day. One day, Jesus, as a faithful groom, will return for his bride, and there will be an amazing wedding in another garden. A restored garden, Garden 2.0. All wrongs made right, all brokenness healed, all evil banished, all death destroyed, all things new. The David and Karissa story. Don't miss this. Some of you have been to a lot of weddings and you might have missed this. The David and Karissa story is today in marriage pointing toward and telling that greater story. That's the purpose of marriage. The story of God, from creation to new creation by way of redemption in Jesus, from incomplete to complete by way of sacrificial love. The Apostle Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 31 to 33, "Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I am saying," says Paul, "that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband." So you see, there is not only great purpose in marriage, but as this passage also clearly states, there are also very important roles in marriage, which help us to more clearly see its purpose. The husband is to lead with sacrificial love, and the wife is to help and to submit with sincere respect. Now, of course, the Bible is so outdated, right? I mean, clearly, every wife here knows that it wouldn't help their marriage at all for her husband to sacrificially love her, to give up his rights and self-serving desires, to carefully protect her and treat her as precious. How outdated. So antiquated, traditional marriage, blah. Of course, you hear I'm being facetious, aren't I? And husbands here know that it would do their marriage no good for their wives to honor and respect them privately and publicly, speaking gently to them and greatly of them, setting aside rights and self-serving desires, patiently supporting them and helping them fulfill their life's ambitions. So outdated. Old fuddy-duddy marriage. The reality is there's an echo in our hearts that these roles are good and beautiful and helpful. They're God's design. Now, Dave and Chris, I charge you to continue learning and living out of this understanding of the purpose of your marriage and your unique God-given roles in your marriage. David, you are to lovingly lead Karissa, to protect her, provide for her, to nurture her, to disciple her, be gentle with her, listen to her, seek to understand her, and heed the wisdom and perspective that she brings. David, may you speak to Karissa and treat her and lead her in such a way that others will see and say, man, look how David treats Karissa. Look at the way he is with her, how he pursues her, protects her, and provides for her, even after all these years. That kind of love and leadership can only come from the work of the Holy Spirit in your heart, in your life. And Karissa, you are to sincerely help David. The boy needs help. And God has brought you into his life to help him, to respect him and encourage him, to submit to him in reverence for Christ, to support him and pray for him, and to heed the vision and perspective that he brings. Karissa, may you help, love, and respect David in such a way that others will look and say, look at how much good Karissa has brought to David's life. See how she speaks to and about him. See how she treats him and looks at him and respects him even after all these years. That kind of respect and humility can only come from the work of the Holy Spirit in your heart and in your life. Now, David and Karissa, almost finished here this portion. We spent some good evenings together. Aaron and I have opened our home and our lives to you, and you've opened your lives to us. We've talked about your marriage and how it forms a new household. It's not Karissa's family. It's not David's family. It's the new David and Karissa family. The two become one. We talked about the importance of agreements, having tools to communicate and build agreements in the various areas of your life and your relationship. We've discussed the triangle of respect, integrity, and forgiveness, with humility being in the center, the key. But I'm very confident and therefore blessed to stand here with you today because I know that you both know and believe that Jesus Christ and Him alone, His grace to you and love for you is the greatest source of preparation and the greatest ongoing example and the greatest daily counsel that you will ever need. Not only for your marriage to last, but for it to be filled with joy. It's such joy to know that your faith is not in yourselves, but in Christ. So by continually rediscovering the good news of God's grace toward you, you will in turn be able to extend that grace to one another. So forgive quickly, settle matters quickly, be humble and admit when you're wrong and know that you will be. Be honest and gentle, careful in what you say and how you say it. Listen carefully and show each other that you're listening. Make eye contact, comfort and support each other. All other relationships and responsibilities now leave their current position on the priority list and take one significant step down. Your marriage becomes your needed focus. In this way, your story and your marriage will continue telling that greater story of the unfailing love of Christ to all those who observe your lives. And God's going to use you in your marriage in your marriage relationship to be a tremendous blessing to many, many others, including any children He may give you as you endeavor to build a family as the Lord leads you. This wedding, this marriage, is a foretaste of something greater to come. Another wedding, the historic garden. That's pretty cool, huh? Pretty cool. Let's pray together. Father, we again just thank You for the incredible meaning that is packed into this moment. We thank You for Your faithfulness to David and Karissa, that You have preserved them for one another, that You've worked in their hearts, that they've sought to honor You and walk with You, and that You've brought them together. You've done it in such a cool way. So, Lord, I pray that You just continue to bless them even in this moment. And we thank You for the story that You are writing in their lives, and that's on display for us here this evening. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now I'm going to ask you guys to turn and face each other and hold hands as you exchange your wedding vows. Start with you, David, and you repeat after me. I, David, take you, Karissa.
I, David, take you, Karissa.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
In wealth and in need.
In wealth and in need.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death us do part.
Till death do us part.
That works. Yeah. Now, Karissa, your turn. Repeat after me. I, Karissa, take you, David.
I, Karissa, take you, David.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
In wealth and in need.
In wealth and in need.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death us do part.
Till death us do part.
Great job. Now, is there a ring for the bride? Little brother comes through. Good job. All right, David, I'll have you place, repeat after me as you place the ring upon Chris's hand. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my love.
As a symbol of my love.
And faithfulness to you.
And faithfulness to you.
Is there a ring for the groom? Repeat after me as you place the ring upon his hand. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my love.
As a symbol of my love.
And faithfulness to you.
And faithfulness to you.
At this time, David and Karissa have chosen to assemble a unity cross to symbolize their covenant that they're making today. It also symbolizes their distinct God-given roles and the two becoming one. The unity cross is a small sculpture that they will have to display in their home, reminding them of the meaning of their marriage. It is made up of a strong, protective outer cross symbolizing the groom and an intricate, beautiful inner cross symbolizing the bride. It's held together by three pegs symbolizing the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit who holds their covenant together. Following the unity cross, they will partake in communion. And during this time, as music plays, I would invite you to reflect upon the meaning of marriage and to pray for David and Karissa.
We will use the words we know. Just listen to our heart. If words could fall like rain from these lips of mine, if I had a thousand years, I would still run out of time. So if you listen to my heart, every beat will say, thank you for the light, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. And listen to our heart,
oh Lord, please listen.
Hear our spirit sing,
and hear us sing
a song of praise that flows.
So
listen to our heart. Thank you for the truth. Thank you for the way. And listen to our heart,
oh Lord, please listen.
Hear our spirit sing,
and hear us sing
a song of praise that flows
so loud
from those you have redeemed.
Amen. And praise the Lord. Well, for as much as David and Karissa have consented together in holy marriage and have witnessed the same before God in this company and have pledged their faithfulness to each other by joining hands, by giving and receiving a ring, therefore, by the authority granted to me as a minister of Jesus Christ, I pronounce that they are husband and wife together in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Those who God has joined together, let no one separate. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. And may the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. David, you may kiss your bride. It is my privilege to introduce to you Mr. and Mrs. David Dobbins. Woo!